Song of Solomon, chapter number 8, the last chapter in the Song of Solomon. We went back to verse 4 on Wednesday night, and the charge of the Shulamite, the beloved of Solomon. And we looked at chapter 2 and verse 7 and 3 and verse 5 when she had done this before. And we got an overview of her trying to instruct church members to be careful about trying to raise up love if you wasn't serious about it. No man having put his hand to this plow and looketh back is fit for the kingdom of God. So she's warning them that the intensity of her love, as she says, is strong as death, verse 6, and is cruel as the grave. And she says, Solomon, my love for you is exactly the same as your love for me. He that loveth not knoweth not God. So she said, what you need to do is the insignia upon your heart that identifies you, the king's insignia that makes everything legal. It ought to be me. Verse 6, set me as a seal upon thine heart. She doesn't say set a seal upon your heart for me. She said, let me be the seal, because I can't stand you backing off from me one slight bit. This jealousy that I have for you is as cruel as the grave. You have got me now, and I have reached the height and the pinnacle of the love of God. And if you, no, not if, and since you proclaimed yourself at the very beginning, and we read in Deuteronomy chapter 4, to be the jealous God, that was your name, then that kind of jealousy dwells in me for you, and you must set me as the seal upon your heart and never, ever back off. So she's warning the church members, and verse 4 in the Amplified reads, I adjure you, I challenge you, I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem. These are people that's been raised up in the church. They never have been sinners. They've just been church members all their life. That you never again attempt to stir up or awaken love until it pleases. That's how the Amplified reads verse 4. We come now to verse number 8. And we see the words, we have a little sister, and she has no breasts. What shall we do for our sister in the day when she shall be spoken for? We're worried about what's going to happen when she does mature and comes into the full figure of a woman. What's going to happen then? And they say there's two possibilities. If she be a wall, we will build upon her a palace of silver. If she is discreet, like a wall, standing there firm, keeping some things out, keeping some things in, then we'll give her a dowry. And if she be a door that swings one way or the other, flirtatious, bold-spirited, not circumspect, not a chaste virgin, we're going to board her up. We will enclose her with boards of cedar. Then she comes back and says, boys, let me tell y'all something. I am a wall. You say if I be a wall. But I want you to know that I am a wall. And my breasts are like towers. Then was I in his eyes as one that found favor. Father, we thank you for your word today. strange it may be to some ears, foreign to the concepts of our own hearts, we being Westerners in a late age have a hard time perceiving and understanding these people of the East back in that early day. But that's not what divides us from this. That which divides us is the lack of our spiritual understanding. For the scriptures are they which testify of me, you said in John 5:39. So we pray, Lord, that we would not come and approach this word as the letter, because the letter of the law killeth. But we come, Lord Jesus, that you might open our hearts as you did the two on the road to Emmaus, and open the scriptures to us that we might perceive and understand that which God is saying to us. So we pray that we would receive the spirit of the word, the person of the word, not just words on a page of a Bible, but the person of the word who is the way, the truth, and the life, and is the access to the Father. So we pray, Lord Jesus, that you would be so kind as to send forth thy Holy Spirit, for you have entrusted him with the things of thine, that he might show them unto us. Grant that you might be glorified among us, and that God's people with spiritual mindedness might be edified and built up. If these things happen, then we shall be able to say, it was good for me that I went unto the house of the Lord today. Thank you for all things, in Jesus' name. Amen. We want to see the scene. Where is this? What's going on? Then another thing that you've got to know in the Song of Solomon are the speakers. Not only the scene, what's happening, but the speakers. Who is it talking? If you don't get come to an understanding of who's doing the talking at that particular time, it will really mess you up. And then we want to see the subject. What was the subject? In verse number 1, it is my mother's breast. And in verse number 8, it is no breasts. And then in verse number 10, it is my breast, a wall, and a tower. So we're seeing these things through the love of Solomon for his bride, the Shulamite. Where do you get that word? Chapter 6 and verse 13. Return, return, O Shulamite. So we see that this is how the Lord is picturing for us the great revelation, a great mystery. I show you a great mystery, not just a mystery. The gospel is called a mystery, but this is a great mystery. What is it concerning Christ and his church? What are you talking about? The man's relationship to the woman as husband and wife is the great mystery. Why is it called a great mystery and the gospel only called a mystery? Because it is common to every nation. Men and women getting married. Maybe there wasn't a ceremony, but they cohabitated. Men and women coming together. It is a common thing. It transcends languages, times, regions. It doesn't matter. Wherever they've been met, men and women, they come together. Therefore, this revelation shall be held accountable for by every soul that's ever lived on the planet Earth. So it's a great mystery. That's what he's talking about. Now, will you be so patient with me to let me reread this passage from the Amplified? I just happen to have the Amplified Bible with me. And it reads like this. You can follow along if you want to in your Bible, but here's what it says. Verse 8. Gathered with her family and the wedding guests in her mother's cottage. How you get that? Verse number 1. She talks about her mother. And she talks about when I got a hold of you and I'm going to let you go, I'm going to take you to my mother's house in verse number 2. So her family and her are gathered together with the wedding guests in her mother's house. The bride said to her stepbrothers, "When I was a little girl," you know what y'all said? You said, "We have a little sister and she has no breasts. What shall we do for our sister on the day when she is spoken for in marriage? If she be a wall, discreet and womanly, we will build upon her a turret, a dowry of silver. But if she is a door, bold and flirtatious, we will enclose her with boards of cedar. Well, I am a wall with battlements and my breast like towers of it. Then was I in the king's eyes as one to be respected and to be allowed to find peace." You don't identify me. You don't define me. My love and the king define me. So she has to go beyond that kinship that God tells each and every one of us we must go beyond. "For a man's foe shall be they of his own household." Matthew chapter 10, 35 down. "Where does the sword fall? I came not to send peace on earth, but a sword. It falls in the family, separating the mother from the daughter-in-law, the father from the son." And he says in Matthew chapter 12 that those people outside wanting to come in here and see me that interrupted my sermon in this house, that's not my mother and my brothers, my sisters. These, my disciples, are my mother and brothers and sisters. So you have been defined at an early stage in your life by natural kinship. So have you been, not only in the physical, by your brothers and sisters and mother and daddy, but you have also been defined in your early Christian spiritual stage by religion that may or may not have a true understanding of Christ and who you are in him. You are going to have to identify yourself with one person, and that's Solomon. Yeah. "How many names are there given unto heaven among men whereby ye must be saved?" One. Look at Ephesians chapter 2. In verse 15, Ephesians 2:15. "Having abolished in his," in Christ's flesh, "the enmity," the strong ill will, that's what that word means, "even the law of commandments, thou shalt not eat this animal, thou shalt eat that animal, you can wear this, you can't wear that," different things that he gave in the law. He said he abolished in his flesh that ill will that was against you, even the law of commandments containing in ordinances. And why did he do that? In order to make of two, Jews and Gentiles, one new man, so making peace. There's only one church. It is absolutely derived from the physical sacrifice of Jesus Christ. That's what that verse is. At the same time that his flesh was being torn by nails, spears, and thorns, the curtain was being ripped in the holy place. And you can't, listen, you can't unring the bell. You can't make it holy again. Once it has been torn open and the atmosphere of the world is rushed in, it's now common. It is not what we are to look for anymore. We don't have to worry about staying in the court of the Gentiles. Jesus said, "Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden." It don't matter, Jew, Gentile, black, white, yellow, green, purple, tall, short, rich or poor. Come unto me if you're laboring and heavy laden. Come on. Amen. Everybody, anybody. So they're saying, "We define you by what we thought you might turn out to be." She said, "I've been a wall all the time, and I am according to that which Solomon is delighted in." Verse 16, "And that he might reconcile both what? Jew and Gentile. Unto God, here we go again. In one body, how? By the cross. Listen, folks, the cross of Jesus Christ accomplished some spiritual, heavenly, permanent things. And one of them is he broke down the middle wall of partition between Jew and Gentile. It ain't got anything to do with either Jew or Gentile. It has to do with sinners and God. Amen. That's it. Good. And that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby. How did he slay it? Verse 15, he abolished it in his flesh. Chapter 4, verse 4, Ephesians 4, 4. Every time I stop, read me two words. Are you ready?
Ready.
All right. Ephesians 4, 4. There is
one body
and
one spirit,
even as you're called in
one hope
of your calling.
One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
Who is above all and through all and in you all. I knew Paul was a southerner. He said in you all. Listen. One, 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 one. No more two. How did that happen? Well, they had a synod and, you know, our synod or whatever. I say that is. S-Y-N-O-D. They had a meeting, a religious meeting. And they said, well, let's vote where we're going to have Jews and Gentiles. And Oliver Green says, yeah, they're going to be the Gentiles on the earth in the dirt, and the Jews are going to be in heaven in the celestial city. Man, you're supposed to be a preacher. What are you? He's dead and gone. I can talk about him now. He can't say nothing to me. Listen, folk, God did that. He did it in Christ. He did it at the cross. He did it when his flesh was torn. He let in everybody. The flowing wounds supply. And in that fountain filled with blood that's drawn from Emmanuel's veins, sinners, not Jews, not Gentiles, but sinners plunge beneath that flood and lose their guilty stains. How do you like them apples?
Amen.
Amen? Amen? All right. I got ahead of myself. Sometime I get on top of myself if it was possible. Listen, go back to chapter 1. In verse number 6 of Song of Solomon. If I don't say a verse and I say 1:6 or 3:5 or 2:7, it's the Song of Solomon. Okay. Go to 1:6. Her brothers are speaking and going to remind her of what they thought about her way back yonder. And she says in Song of Solomon 1:6, look not upon me because I am black. She's been out in the sun. She has been working as a laborer in the field. She's not of royalty. She's not of the powdered and nice little flowery daughters of Jerusalem, you know, and all of their delicacy. She's a hardworking woman out in the sun. Picturing the sinner. Look not upon me because I am black, because the sun hath looked upon me. My mother's children. Be sure you understand that phrase. Well, it ain't much to understand. Good. Then you got it right. My mother's children were angry with me. They made me the keeper of the vineyards, but mine own vineyard have I not kept. Now, what was that phrase? I told you, you better remember it.
My mother's children.
All right, 6:9. Song of Solomon 6:9. My dove, my undefiled is two words.
One.
She is three words.
The only one.
Of her mother. Now wait a minute. Wait a minute. We just got through reading in 1:6, my mother's children. If it hadn't been but one girl and it was her, it would say my mother's child. But there's children. Now we're reading, she is, and you said it, but one, and she is, you said it, the only one of her mother. She, not them, this girl, This female, this she, is the choice one of her that bare her. Now the daughters of Jerusalem saw her and blessed her, yea, the queens and the concubines, and they praised her. What do you get when you listen at Psalm 1:6 and Psalm 6:9? That she's the only daughter there is, and the rest of them's all old knucklehead boys.
That's right.
So they're at the house. Here's all the boys. And you know what boys gonna do if there's this one sister? Drive her crazy. That's what boys' mission in life is to drive their sisters crazy. And if they ain't got a sister, they'll borrow a cousin, just in case that row back there thinks that they're getting left out. That's what husbands do. Ladies, come on. Drive you crazy. So here we are at Mama's house, chapter 8, verse 2. Who starts talking? Well, verse 8 starts off with a plural pronoun. I think that's a pronoun, ain't it? We have a little sister. They're remembering old Lang Syne. One of the reasons I don't like to get together with my natural family is they want to start telling stories about what we all did way back yonder. And somehow or another, because I was only redhead, believe me, I got pictures. In the crowd, they think I was the one that, you know, made all the trouble. So I don't want to hear it. And they start talking about what they thought she was. This is the scene. This is the scene. The ones that's doing the speaking in verses 8 and 9, which you've got to get right, are the brothers. We had a little sister. They're reminding of her of what she was not. And they are simply moralists who are concerned legally about appearances so that she doesn't bring shame on the family. That is a predominant power in the religious world, and it has ruined a lot of people. But we want you to understand Genesis 24. Let's just take some time. You ain't going nowhere, are you? Genesis 24, verse 29. That brothers in the East, back in those days, had, if not the same amount of authority, had just about as much authority as the father did. Genesis 24 and verse 29. This is when the servant is going to get Rebekah. Verse 29 of Genesis 24. And Rebekah had a
brother,
and his name was Laban. And Laban ran out unto the man, Abraham's servant, unto the well. Verse 50. Then Laban, and who is he? He's her what?
Brother.
And Bethuel, who is her
father.
Her daddy, answered and said, "The thing proceedeth from the Lord." Next word.
We.
Same word starts off chapter 8 and verse 8 of Song of Solomon. We, us men folks, cannot speak unto thee bad or good. Verse 55. And her brother and her mother. Now, there's one time when Bethuel, her dad, speaks, and it is this time when her mother speaks, but neither one of them speak without Laban, her brother. The brother is included as having equal voice with either mama or daddy. And that girl's life is greatly dependent upon what her brother thinks of her. In the natural way, you know, second causes. And her brother and her mother said, "Let the damsel abide with us a few days, at the least 10. After that she shall go." And he, the servant of Abraham, said unto them, "Hinder me not, seeing the Lord has prospered my way." Y'all don't hinder me, because God is not hindering me. He's prospering my way. "Send me away that I may go to my master." I can't get her out of here unless The parents and the brother agree for her to go with me. And they said, we will call the damsel and inquire her mouth. And they called Rebecca and said unto her, wilt thou go with this man? And she said, I will go. It's the same pattern that you have in Song of Solomon chapter 8. Her brother said, you used to be flat as iron and bold. You was a skinny little old girl with freckles and pigtails, and you looked more like a boy than you did a girl. And we was wondering about you, and we were scared because you're the only daughter. You're going to mess up and bring shame on the family. We. And then she says, I am a wall. How did God introduce himself to the children of Israel in Egyptian bondage? Exodus 3:14. Who shall I say has sent me to them people down there under Pharaoh's bondage? I am that I am. You're going to have to come and stand before the I am as you am. We, they, us, brother, mama, brother, daddy, no, I will go. You can't put this off on the preacher. You can't put it off on your mama or your daddy. You can't put this off on what? Well, let's get the family together and take a vote. That's how they got the wrong apostle, and they messed up the apostle Paul for the rest of his ministry, voting in somebody we ain't never heard of to fill Judas's place. You need to do what you need to do, son. You need to do what you need to do, daughter, because it's right with God and you. Listen, you may get a bicycle built for two. You may get a bicycle built for two, but you ain't going to find no cross built for two. I know whom, not what, whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against the day of judgment. Well, you know, I would do so and so if my husband would. Well, why don't you just let him take you to hell with you, with him? Well, you know, if my wife would do so and so. Cop out. I will go with this man. I am a wall. Bless God, if you got any spiritual integrity, state it before God and the Holy Ghost and the angels and all men, and stand up for Jesus and proclaim him to be what you need and who you are loving and who is drawing you. Because listen, faith is nothing if it's not personal. Hast thou faith? Romans 14:22. Have it to thyself before the Lord. Well, you know, here's a southern word. It's all one word. It takes a lot to break it down. If mama them, y'all grinning, you know what I'm talking about, don't you? Because you said, mama them's out in the front yard. Mama them's one word, front yard's one word. Well, if mama them was to do so and so, then I believe I would know what to do. Mama them didn't die on the cross for you, honey.
Right. Right.
Come on!
That's true. Amen.
Get off the fence. You're either for God or you ain't. Right. Well, we, well, they, well, the brothers, well, this. No. Isn't that amazing? I will go. Listen to verse 59 of Genesis 24. And they said, we will, no, 59. And they sent away Rebekah, their sister, and her nurse, and Abraham's servant, and his men. And they sent away. They did one thing right when they sent away the individual who says, I will go. Isn't that great? Isn't that amazing? Judges 21. Judges chapter 21. If you run into the book of Ruth, turn back one page. Judges 21 and verse 21. These old boys was having a hard time finding wives, so they were going to make a raid down on this tribe and steal women. That's the background. Here it comes. Judges 21:21. And see and behold, if the daughters of Shiloh come out to dance in dances, then come ye out of the vineyards and catch you every man his wife of the daughters of Shiloh and go to the land of Benjamin. You want a wife? Steal one. Now listen at the next verse. And it shall be when their fathers, three words. I ain't going no further. Quit reading it. I'm making a point. There's going to be somebody going to come after you, and it can be either their fathers, and what was your three words?
Or
their brethren come unto us to complain, that we will say unto them, be favorable unto them for our sakes, because we reserve not to each man his wife in the war. For ye did not give unto them at this time that ye should be guilty. I don't know what all that means, but it just means that you're going to have to argue with their brothers, if not the father. Or both of them on equal level. Isn't that right? 2 Samuel, this will be the last one. 2 Samuel, don't get excited. I didn't say the last scripture for the message. I just said this last one on this point. 2 Samuel 13. In verse number 22. 2 Samuel 13 in verse 22. And Absalom spake unto his brother Amnon, neither good nor bad, for Absalom hated Amnon because he had forced his sister Tamar. What did the daddy do in verse 21? It don't say what he did. It just said how he felt. And when King David heard of all of these things, he was wroth. Absalom is the one that murdered Amnon because it was his sister that Amnon forced. So this is highly important. This is gospel stuff. You can't skip over the word we in chapter 8 and verse 8 of the Song of Solomon. You got to find out who's talking. And who's talking are her brothers. And they're judging her according to morality. And he said, we knew you when you wasn't nothing. And we evidently had a council about it. We talked about it. You know, it's amazing how people know how to live my life for me, but they don't know how to live their life for them.
Amen.
But her brothers knew what she ought to do and was judging her according to whether she would be a door or a wall. And we got a plan for both of them. If it's plan A, we'll do this. But if that fails, we got plan B. We're going to take care of you in a way that suits us. Folks, I'm going to tell you something. If it ain't happened yet, it will happen. You mess around with God, and she warns them, don't mess around with love until it pleases. If you are going to involve yourself in the kingdom of God, you better be determined to involve yourself in the kingdom of God if nobody else in the world agrees with it. That's what Jesus did for you. He left his father in heaven. He left his mother on earth. And he clung to his bride on that cross. And God said, for this cause shall a man leave his mother and father and cleave unto his bride. Mm-mm-mm. One-on-one. I am not some way. I am the way. I am not any truth. I am the truth. There is no other life but me. The way is narrow and the gate is straight. And if you come to God, you come by me. You come by me. That's it. It's you who must decide. It's you who must choose you this day whom you will serve. It's you whether you want to go wrong with the brothers and take the easy route. But I'm going to tell you something. It ain't going to be easy after that seventh trumpet sounds. He that denieth me before men, I promise you, I give you my word as the truth, I will deny you before God Almighty and the holy angels. Well, we think you ought to go to this church. We think you ought to do this. Okay, thank you. Appreciate you, you know, your opinions, but opinions are like noses. Everybody's got one. Just let me walk with God by faith. And she did. Now, that's who's speaking in verse 8 and 9. The scene is at the mother's house. Everybody's gathered together. The brothers get to talking about old Lang Syne, and we remember when you were young. And we want you to know that we had a contingency plan to keep you straight. They are actually taking credit for her being there with Solomon then. We had this thing lined up. She said, wait a minute. So in verse number 10, who's speaking? The bride. I am a wall. My soul. I am a wall. She is saying, yes, there may be two things that you can compare, the insecure and the young soul to. Either they're going to be a door swinging on hinges, they go either way, or a wall. But I want you to know, I am, Brother Jamie, what was that you said this morning about the tenses of words, hath. Didn't you say that he already had made Jesus? She said, I already am a wall. It didn't have nothing to do with y'all. Let me show you what she said. Chapter 2 and verse 9. Chapter 2 and verse 9 of Song of Solomon. My beloved, which is Solomon, is like a roe or a young hart. What is that? It's a Bambi. That's Bambi, ain't it? That's a deer, right? My beloved is like a deer. Now, would you read me down to the second comma? Behold, down to the next comma. Behold.
He standeth behind our wall.
You need me to explain that to you? She said, I am a wall, and this is where my beloved stands. He said, I'll come up to you and whisper in your ear from behind you, this is the way, walk ye therein. When did God elect you to be that wall that he's going to stand behind? Before them brothers ever got here, I'll tell you that. She said, I am. That don't allow for no past, present, or future. It just is. As long as God has been God, I am. He has been standing with me before I ever knew it.
Right.
Ain't God good?
Amen.
And it was electing love that did it.
Right.
One of the things that I despise about the age that I grew up in was that the church was always feeling like that she had to do everything or sinners were going to go to hell. There are certain things God told us to do, but some of these things they come up with is way beyond that which God instructed them to do. In so much that they could really consign you to heaven and hell according to their feelings for you. But dear soul, she said, I am. Just like God said, I am that I am. Just like Jesus said, I am the door. I am the bread of life. I am the true vine. I am the shepherd, good shepherd, great shepherd. She said, I am a wall. And God did it. Bless God. Listen, if you ain't got some pre-foundation work in your salvation, you need to study your Bible to get saved, one, because God started this thing out a long time before there was ever a tick or a talk, because there wasn't no earth to revolve around the sun. There wasn't nothing. It was just God loving his people, and he made them all walls. It wasn't an if they might be a door, for in him is no variance or shadow of turning. He don't wobble on the axle. Isn't that good? So he stands behind the wall. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We didn't know whether you were going to be sanctified or loose as a goose, dancing half naked and drunk with a lampshade on your head, standing on a table. She said, well, I did. God did. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. What can you attribute your sanctification to, Christian? What was that subject you're going to talk about on April the 1st, Karen?
I can do nothing without Christ.
Say, I can do nothing without him. Wasn't that it?
Yeah.
I can do how much? Nothing without him. To what do you attribute your sanctification? Well, we don't smoke and we don't chew and we don't go with the ones that do. You're just as good as our brothers. Legalistic morality ain't going to get you into heaven. In fact, it will get you into hell. Listen, I'm going to start with verse 28. God hath chosen the base things of the world and the things which are despised, like this Shulamite, hath God chosen. And the things which are not. She was not a daughter of Jerusalem. She didn't have any royal heritage. She was not in the lineage of the hierarchy and the royalty. She was an old sinner coming out of the sun, put in bondage by her brothers. And dear soul, listen, Adam, your brother put you in bondage. The only hope's come to Christ. To bring to nothing things that are. Listen, why? Verse 29, that no flesh should glory in his presence. That eliminates the brothers. It is not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy.
Amen.
He has washed us in regenerating grace.
Amen.
I am a wall. Stick with me now. No flesh should glory in his presence. You can't get in if your flesh glories. Listen, then how do you get in? What made you sanctified? But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us, number one,
wisdom.
Number two,
righteousness.
Number three,
sanctification.
And sum it all up.
Redemption.
I'll eat your hat if it didn't say sanctification in there. And how did you made sanctified? Through the blood of the Lamb of God, through his obedience. If Jesus Christ don't obey God, I'm going to hell.
That's right. That's true.
If Jesus Christ don't fully satisfy God, I'm in trouble. Because I don't have any sanctification. I don't have any ability to. The only thing an old dead sinner can do is stink. If you don't believe it, ask the sisters of Lazarus. Lord, by this time he's stinking. That's all I can do. Dressed in his righteousness alone. Faultless to stand before the throne. Glory to God and praise the Lord Jesus Christ. Brother Jamie, I appreciate you throwing them crowns at his feet this morning. Listen, now all of you read me verse 31.
That according as it is written, he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord.
you better say, I am a wall. This is me. This is what I am. I don't care what you said I could have been or what I might have been or why you were motivated to have a plan A and plan B in case I wobbled on the axle. I want you to know one thing. I am a wall, and I have to say that because that way the one who stands behind me in Psalm 2:9 gets all the glory. That's what it says. Isn't that right?
Amen.
1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. First Peter 1, 1. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers. They're strange to the world, sojourners, pilgrims, and strangers, scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. You strangers are elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through, read me the next phrase.
Sanctification of the Spirit.
Your election was absolutely connected with sanctification by the Spirit. The election of God included the redemption of Jesus Christ and the sanctification of the Holy Ghost. It's all one sentence. It's all one thing. It's not three different things that are disjointed. It's one thing spoken in three different ways because of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Elect according to the foreknowledge of God through sanctification of the Spirit. And it is unto obedience. She was not going to be disobedient because God's sanctification won't let you be disobedient because that which is born of God sinneth not.
Right.
You say, well, does that mean a Christian can't sin? No, I didn't say that. A Christian's got two births. Some of you is born of your mom and daddy, but the rest of you is born of God. But that part that God put in there, sin is not.
Right.
Come on now.
Right.
Am I telling you the truth?
Yeah.
I'm trying to open up scriptures for you this morning. Listen, sanctification of the Spirit unto obedience. You cannot have a sanctified, elected soul who is not obedient. I am a wall. I ain't no door. Unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace unto you and peace be multiplied. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Hold your place. Romans 4:25. Hold your place. Romans 4:25. The cross of Jesus Christ purchased some absolute things that cannot be undone. They are provided by that work of Jesus Christ on the cross. And listen, he said, by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Listen, it says in Romans 4:25, talking about Jesus our Lord in verse 24, Jesus our Lord was delivered to the cross for our offenses and was raised again for
our justification.
You can call me hyper all you want. You ain't going to bother me none. But I believe with all my soul, one part of justification was accomplished completely when Jesus Christ came out of the grave.
Amen.
Now, my great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather wasn't born yet. He had to come all the way down to me. And I come out of my mother's womb speaking lies. I was a stinking, rotten sinner. And that justification, although it was absolutely accomplished by Jesus Christ, or he couldn't have come out of the grave. He was raised for justification. Was he raised? Yes. Then justification is locked in. But the application thereof is by the Holy Ghost.
Right.
And he made application. Some people say, I'm eternally justified. Well, I'll go along with that if you explain it to me. I don't think anybody's so justified that they don't have to repent.
Amen.
I don't think you're eternally justified. And you say, well, I can do anything I want to, and God can't send me to hell.
Amen.
I don't believe that. God don't save anything but sinners, but he's already got the justification already done.
Right.
You know, the old metal thing when the triangle, ling, 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 ling. Come and get it! Who's going to come and get it? Hungry Jack. Mama's got the biscuits coming out of the oven. The gravy's already on the table, and the fried chicken is just piping hot. Not mashed potatoes. Honey, don't give me no mashed potatoes. Cream potatoes I'm talking about. Green beans come out of the garden, and fresh squash and okra. And a big old apple pie sitting up there cooling on the windowsill. Come and get it. It's already done. Are you hungry? That's all you got to come to the table with is a hungry desire for God. Blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness. Come and get it. Justification's already done. Chicken's on the table. Are you hungry?
Amen.
You hear me?
Amen.
I got it down here where you live because I can't get it no higher. This is where I live. Oh, my soul. Back to our 1 Peter chapter 1. We'll try to finish this up. Verse 3, 1 Peter 1, 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible, undefiled, and it won't fade away. What happened to that church you had that you liked so much? It used to be blue, now it's kind of white. It faded out. There's some folks up the street put a statue on a pine stump, and it was blue, solid blue. And that was back when we first moved there, back in 77. It's solid white now. Where'd the blue go? It faded away. But this ain't going to fade away. What do they call it, ladies, when the colors won't fade? Color fast? What do they call it? Y'all know what? Anyhow, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled and that fadeth not away. Listen, I got a reservation. Woo! I got a reservation. You know where it is? Same place yours is if you got one. It's reserved in heaven for me. And listen, how you know you're going to get there? Verse 5. Who are kept by the... Through what?
Salvation.
Unto what?
Salvation.
What kind of salvation is that? That's a complete, total completion of salvation. That don't mean salvation like, oh, he was lost, now he got saved. No, this means... Whom he foreknew, them he also justified. Whom he justified, them he also called. Whom he called, them he also glorified. It means God's going to complete your salvation. Because you know what? God don't do no sloppy work. And he that hath begun a good work in you, he will perform it unto the day of Jesus Christ. I need him to do that. I need him to do that. I got tickets in the drawer at home for various things that I never did make it to the event. Already had them bought, but I couldn't find my way over there. They didn't have GPS back then. I missed it. But bless God, Jesus got my tickets right here. And son, he's going to come get me and take me into his presence. Come on now.
Amen.
You're going to send the holy angels after me. Said he ain't got sense enough to make it even to the ball game without getting lost. I know he can't make it to heaven. Go get him.
That's right.
Amen. Me too.
Yeah.
David said, is there anybody of Jonathan's seed that I might show mercy to?
Yeah.
Old Mephibosheth. Well, tell him to come on over here. He can't do it. Why? He can't walk. He's lame on his feet. He's crippled. David said, y'all go get him. Son, that'd make a Presbyterian shout.
Yeah.
y'all go get him. But I'm going to tell you this, folks. You ain't going to be able to make it to the end if you're going to wobble on the axle at the beginning. You're going to have to appreciate anybody that's trying to help you, directing you towards Christ. But you can't go in on the buddy system with them. I'm going to start a sentence. You finish it. I must needs go home. There is no other way but this. Finish this one. If I ne'er get sight of the gates of light,